Good evening to you all. My name is Elisha Chitsenga from Zimbabwe, Africa. As you can see, I'm here to present my presentation on how to develop open source business applications. That's my presentation, the second one after the France one in 2019 OSS. Then this is the tweet from the Linux Foundation promoting my tweet, my talk. As you can see, in this talk, we are going to learn how to develop open source business applications. From me, I'm also available on Twitter, as you can see. Then from my presentation, you're going to learn how the African society is all about, how the African culture is all about, especially in beer brewing events. Open source in Africa has been there for a long time, as we have experienced through I've lived in rural areas where there was this beer brewing ceremony in which each and everyone, all age groups and gender, they could come together and begin to do such thing like beer brewing. Everyone will be there and everyone will be assisting, like the boys will be cutting firewood, the women will be fetching some water and preparing the beer. Here's the process it goes like. So simple. Firstly, they soak the rapok or maize for several days in water, moisture, and they let it, they drain the moisture, they drain the water, and after that they let it begin to sprout. After that they spread the ingredient mixture in the sun, as you can see from the slide. After that they ground it into meal, then they add some cold water while boiling and repeating the process. They repeat the process there after that, which means after 7 days the traditional beer will be ready. As we are here in Open Source North America Summit, this is the way we used to do in Africa, and also that the way we do it in application development, and how you are going to learn the open source business development, the application development, is how we prepare our traditional beer here in Africa. Then we move on to the modern world. As you are seeing from the slide, business applications, they started early in the early 80s, where the CAD/CAM software, pioneered by the Hewlett Packard and the IBM. In that one, we have some challenges with it. As you can see, we have so many people working around facilitating the business to move forward. But to solve that, they come up with the software, business software, in order to reduce the labor, but it was expensive. Then there was dramatic shift in the development of business software, where there's business software which was developed, especially softwares like Microsoft Excel, Lotus 1-2-3. And that one, it leads to the early 90s, where there's a massive shift in supply in software development, which is the globalism. In the 1990s, where we see the SAP software being pioneered during the process, and we move on. That one was mainly used in supply chain vendors, for example. Then move on to the current, where we are. Currently, where we are in the robotic process automation period, where we see some of the tasks which we need to, which was being repetitive, done, but we need to avoid some errors when doing business. That's when we moved on to the robotic process automation. period in order to improve efficiency, reduce cost, as well as human error. Then as we move forward, you are going, in this presentation, you're going to learn software development methodologies. We are now in the main presentation. Thank you for joining me. As we move on, software development methodology. This is this track that organizations use to plan and control development of information systems and new software business applications. We all, in our organizations, we need some applications, but we need to plan for it in order to develop our software and business application. Just because we are in the era of fast increasing in system complexity, we need to implement new systems in order to be competitive in the market. So open source practitioners in software development have to adopt this way so that the organization can strive forward. Then we go on to the business application development lifecycle. This business application development lifecycle, we can call BED. It's BED life, as you can see. It is a life cycle where each phase is an incremental step that lays foundation for the next one to ensure effective management and control in business applications. As you can see from that, we deploy an application, we do some maintenance, we retire that application, and that process keep on doing, repeating itself, as you are seeing from the slide. But the next software we are going to make after following this process, which I'm going to take you through, it's a better version of the previous one. So we move on to the categories in which business applications are being made. Firstly, we have organization-centric business applications and user-centric business applications. Firstly, I'm going to talk about the organization-centric business application. Its objective is to facilitate business on a need-to-know basis. As you know, in organization, we have several departments in which each and every department has got its own work. Like here, we collect some information, we collect it, and we store it. We archive it, and we share it to the users, customers, vendors. That's what organization-centric business applications is to do. Then we go on to the business software methodologies. We are continuing the software development methodology. As you guys seeing, we use the sales data so that they will be available to accounts, admin, and the government agencies or levy payments. It is. And also business applications are essential mainly into the regulatory area, especially in the levy fulfillment, i.e. tax compliance, which is addressed by those organization-centric application. Organization-centric application projects use SDOC methods, which is a more detailed software engineering approaches. More detailed to mean it is well defined and it is clearly stated. Each and everyone understands it. That's all it. It is about the organization-centric application. Then move on to the second one, which is user-centric business application. User-centric business application, they mainly provide an objective or it provide a different view of data. We have our applications, but we need such data to be presented in a presentable way. For example, we have DCN support system or geographic information system, which we use. They use user-centric because they need to provide a different view of data for performance optimization. Then this user-centric application, they use alternative development approaches, while the organization-centric, they use the more defined or traditional software development methodologies. Then we move on to how do we come up with those business-centric applications? We need to have some key drivers. What if it happened? What is going on? A business application is developed, project usually generally initiated as a result of the following. Firstly, we have a new opportunity that relates to new or existing business practices. What's a new opportunity? Like here in Africa, the opportunities are limitless. There are so many opportunities, but with the use of a business applications, we can formulate a new business application. Then the secondly, we have an opportunity that enable an organization to take advantage of technology. Like here we are in the time of COVID-19. For some business it's an opportunity, for some it's a loss. That's business, that's all about it. But we need some applications to know that facilitate us forward. Thirdly, we have alignment of business applications with business partners or industry standards. If we are in the industry which is highly regulated, like the health industry or the financial industry, there are some standards which need to be followed. There are some standards and some practices which requires us to be guided. So that one is one of the key drivers that can lead us to business application development. Then fourthly, we have the problem with that relates to existing business processes. The existing business processes we are having some problems in and out. We might encounter that by developing a new business application. Then we move on to a problem with current technology. We might have a problem with current technology. That might be a key business driver, a game changer. Then we go on to the next of this slide, which we are going to talk about these attributes of business functions. What are attributes of business functions? Like here in open source projects, objectives have to be translated. That's some of the attributes which we use to achieve the behavior and implementation of business function to achieve the strategic goals. That's all critical in open source objective. Like those key business drivers have to be translated to all parts involved in business operations, so that everyone will understand, we can move on with the projects we are doing. Then we go on to what those objectives have to be like. They need to be smart, so that they can be expressed in a scorecard form, which allows an objective evidence to be collected in order to measure the business value of an application and prioritize requirements. The key benefit of this approach is that a common and clear understanding of business objective and how they contribute to business function. Additional conflicting key business drivers, such as the cost and functionality, and mutually dependent key business drivers have to be detected and resolved early in the stages of a project development. So that we won't have hiccups during the way. Then we move on. How do we communicate those business needs to management or to the stakeholders in the business? Firstly, we need to identify a problem. What is the problem we are facing? What is the problem we encounter? We need to identify a need or a problem in order for our applications to work or our application to be successful in our business. What the need we need to address. and or what the problem we need to tackle. From there, we need to specify a desired solution. What is the solution we can talk about? We can work around this problem we have identified. We have the currently we have COVID. Currently, here in Africa, we have some communicable diseases like malaria. It is a problem. But what the solution? We need to specify a desired solution to that problem. And after that, we relate potential benefits to the organization. After identifying the need, we identify the solution, we relate the potential benefit to the organization. What that problem? How are we going to fit it into our organization structure so that we can come up with an application, we can develop an application that will be successful in the market? All internal and external factors affected by the problem should be identified. We need to identify the internal and external factors in order for our applications to be successful. Then we move on to the several software development models. We have the traditional waterfall model, we have the V-shaped model with iterative model. So I'm going to talk about them one by one. Firstly, we have the traditional SDLC model. SDLC just stands for Software Development Lifecycle. As you can see, software development lifecycle, we start, we analyze a situation, we design an application, we implement it, we test it, we deploy it, we do some maintenance. So it is a cycle which continues, goes around like that. This model normally involves the lifecycle verification approach that ensures potential mistakes are corrected early and solely during the final acceptance testing. Then this is the oldest and widely used in developing applications. It works when the project's requirements are stable and well-defined. As you can see, it facilitates determination of a system architecture relatively in the development effort. It is based on a systematic and sequential approach to software development. And the primary advantage to this, it provides a template into which methods or requirements can be placed, as you can see. Then we go on to the shortfalls of this approach. We have some problems with it. Unanticipated events can in iterations, creating problems, difficult in obtaining explicit set of requirements, managing requirements and convincing the user about undue oriented requirements, the necessity of customer patience, which requires the approach, this working version of the systems program, and also changing business environment can alter the requirements that are going to be delivered. Then we go on to the second one. The second one is iterative model. This one is a cyclical process in which business requirements are developed, tested in iterations until the entire application is developed. During each iteration, the development process goes through each phase, from the requirements through testing, and each subsequent increase incrementally improves the process. As you can see from the diagram, we have a set of requirements. What the requirements we have for this application? We do the first build or first version of the application. We do some design and development, we test it and we implement it. After implementing it, we see some problems. Then we go on that same first build, we do a second build, second version of it. We do some design and development, which is improvement of the build one. We do some testing, we implement it into the market. After that, we have some problem, we do a build three. We design, we develop, test it, and implement it. So that's how it goes. So until we have the final version of what we want. Then we have the last one. The last one, which is the verification and validation model. The verification and validation model, which is the V model. V model emphasizes the relationship between development phase and testing phase. If we develop something like a code, we need to do some testing of it so that to validate if that code works. And the most granular testing is the unit test, occurred immediately after the code is being written. Testing occurs to validate the detailed design. As you can see, we do some component testing to see the general design specification. We do some unit testing to view the detailed design specifications. And we do some acceptance testing to see if the requirements matches what the user wants. So system testing relates, which is the last one, which relates to the architectural specification of the system, while the final user acceptance testing reference the requirements. If you meet the requirements, we do the final user acceptance testing. If the customer accepts those requirements, we have met it. That is success of our application. So I'm done with my presentation. And the last slide is just to thank you all. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for joining me. Thank you so much, the Linus Foundation. Thank you so much, the team behind the scenes. Thank you very much. We can say it in our local language, Tatenda, Siawonga, Kakulu. Thank you very much. I'm ready to entertain your questions.